Good morning. Good morning. My name is Kevin Nooner. I'm the lay leader here at First United Methodist Church in Springfield, and I am glad that you have chosen to join us today to worship. We've got a couple of announcements. One of those is that we've got a Lenten study that's coming up that I will actually be leading starting this week. I say that only to say that as I was preparing for the study starting on Wednesday, one of those things that comes up is talking about worship and how we gather together with really two big purposes. Number one, to tell God thank you. And number two, to tell him that we love you. And so I'm glad that you have chosen to join us, whether you're here as a regular attender or a visitor, or you've joined us by Facebook, we're glad to have you. So we got a couple of announcements I'm going to go through. Remembered by glasses this week, which always makes this much easier. So let's start with these gorgeous flowers, the chancel flowers, that are given in memory of Kathy Raines, who is the founder of the Sunshine Class, and that was given by John and Cindy Fike. As you continue through the bulletin, you will see that we do have several people that we have on our prayer list here. I do want to raise in Christian sympathy Wayne Reeder and the family and the death of his wife, Catherine Reeder. And then as you continue to the right side, you'll see that the date is coming up really close for Sacred Sparks consignment sale. We've been talking about that for a few weeks now, and it's here. So Wednesday night together, we'll actually be in the fellowship hall because we'll be setting up for that in the Moore Center. So just know that that is this weekend. You will see that we have a short meeting this afternoon for adult Sunday school leaders in the fellowship hall at 1:30. I've already talked about that Wednesday night together. And then I also want to draw attention on the bottom of the church calendar coming up on Sunday, the March the 8th. There's some information there about the young adult ministry. We'll be sending some care packages. So if you want to be involved in that, so give you some information to help plan ahead for next Sunday. We've got several other informational things that's on there with the announcements. I'll let you read those and pay attention closely to those that are especially applicable to you. And we have a ministry moment now that we'd like to share with you.
I'm Martha Nelson, and I'd like to take a minute to tell you a little bit about Laundry Love. It was started, it's a national movement, soon to be international, started in Ventura, California after 9/11. A group of people got together and formed We Are One, a nonprofit organization dedicated to doing small things to bring us together. We were so separated after 9/11 in many ways, and with different cultures and people and blame and shame and all the things that went on in our human world. They said, let's do some things. We're not going to build houses. We're not going to do big things. We're going to do little things to make people understand each other better and come closer. Laundry Love was started by that group, and one of their workers was in Ventura working the city with the homeless population, and there was a well-known homeless man named Max. He had been, I believe, a college professor, but somehow his foot got on that slippery slope and down he went, and he was homeless, but he was well thought of and loved, and one of the We Are One workers came up and said, Max, if I came alongside you, and that language struck me when I saw the information about it, because it wasn't like, how am I going to fix you? How am I going to, what if I came alongside you? And that's so important. And just, what could we do that would make your life better? And instantly, Max replied, if I had some clean clothes, maybe people would look at me as if I were a human being again. Wow. We do. We eat with our eyes first, and we judge people by what we see first. So Laundry Love was started last year. It's around the country in, I'm not sure exactly how many, I think it's like 65 locations now. It's all volunteer-based. It's all financed by the local organization. There's no money from the top or anything. And last year did 1.94 million loads of laundry around the country for those who need it. It's not just the homeless. It's those who are on that poverty edge. In Springfield, we have all of that, and we have also seniors who can't get down to their laundry room, are fearful of that, or they can't do their bedding. It's just too heavy to carry around. We do a lot of bedding, we find, because that's something that if you are struggling to feed your children and put $20 of gas in the car, you're not going to spend $26 to do the comforter. So we started it here, my late husband Mark and I. We're in our third year now. We do it up at Sisters Coin Laundry in the Belt Plaza. It's It's all volunteer run. We have a steering committee now, and this year we are moving to become a 501c3 nonprofit because we've gotten so big. And this past year, we did 9,943 loads of laundry, washed, dried, folded, and freshly bagged. But that's just 50% of it. The other half is the fellowship, the ministry, the being in the vineyard, the breaking down. It's like, stop by. We do it the third Friday of every month at Sisters Corn. You'll see these people come in with us, our friends and neighbors, in all sorts of conditions, and we hug each other like it's old home week. Where are you, Judy? What are you doing? Did you get the job? And we fellowship. We always have coffee and stuff. Their kids come. Dr. Causey from our school district, Robertson County, he sends a teacher who reads to the children in the back and does that. I mean, it's just it's a wonderful way, and we do a ton of laundry. But it's a wonderful way to get to know people and help them, and it makes a huge difference. We have many children who would not be in school if it weren't for Laundry Love because they can't have clean clothes and they don't want to go to school. I work closely with Lisa Cobb, whom most of you who are in the school district or in this community know, is just the most wonderful social organizer and worker. So we work closely to help families in all different states of being and try and help them this one way. And they love it. They really do. They're so appreciative. So I thank you. The Springfield First United Methodist Church was so gracious when I asked, would you carry our money for me? Because I don't want to form a checking account and carry it myself. I want guards and people to know how much is in there, and I'm not doing it. And graciously, and Terry Price has been wonderful taking that over. So that's a mission that you have adopted. And we have many, many volunteers from here. I could start to list them, but I'd probably leave someone out. So I've learned a long time ago not to do that. But we have probably 15 volunteers from this church who are wonderful to Laundry Love, dependable, and give of their time, their resources, and their talents. So it's the gift of the Spirit in action in the vineyard. It's grace, it's goodness, it's kindness, it's peace, it's joy. Join us. I'd love to have you find out what it's about and join us in this mission work. We need a mobile shower for this group of people parked in our parking lot. That's the next step. It's a long, hot summer here in Springfield, Tennessee. And if you can imagine not having a shower for weeks in that heat, that's the next step. Let's try and do that together. I love you. Thank you. Bye.
It is indeed a wonderful ministry that our church and many other churches and organizations here in town participate in, and encourage you to get involved. As Martha so eloquently said, can you imagine simply not having clean clothes? It's hard for us to imagine that. So let's put our hands and feet to the love of Christ. Amen. Stand together with us. Let's join our voices as we worship today.
Come, now is the time to worship. To give your heart, come, just as you are to worship, come, just as you are before your God, come. One day every tongue will confess you are God, one day every knee will bow. For those who gladly choose you now.
you would, look around you. Welcome each other to God's house.
Be seated, please. Amen. It's good to see all of y'all. There's a bunch of y'all. That makes me happy. That makes me joyful that you all want to be here today. As we sang that last song, we were confronted by the love of Jesus Christ that went all the way. Because of that love that He freely gave, you are redeemed, you are ransomed, you are bought at a price, you are beloved, you are a child of God. And so thank you for being here to worship God and to thank Jesus. And when you're confronted with what Hillsong calls the scandal of grace, Jesus, you died in our place so our souls will live on. Let us give God thanks for that. Lord, I get emotional. I get emotional when I think about that you gave up your son for us. Not just for me and my family, for everybody. Even those who don't accept it. Even those who can't understand it. And Lord, there's going to come a day where every knee will bow and every tongue will have to confess, oh Jesus, you are Lord. Thank you for your grace and for the fact that we know right now that we don't have to find out after the fact that you died in our place so our soul will live on. Lord, this should move us. It should overpower us. It should cause us to want the whole world to know this. So, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, today we come to worship you, to be empowered by you, to be filled and satisfied by you, the bread of life, the one thing that will cause us never to hunger again. All I can say is, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hear the word of God as written in the book of John in the 6th chapter. The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake realized that only one boat had been there, and that Jesus had not entered it with his disciples, but that they had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. And once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" And Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." And then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works that God requires?" And Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." And so they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" And Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." And Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And at this, the Jews there began to grumble about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven."
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Kevin. Good morning.
Good morning.
I see y'all fanning. I don't have the heat on, but I'm afraid to turn the air on. It's that in-between season. But I don't have a tie on, so that helps a little bit. Pastor Jerry cannot be here today. He is actually working for the conference and the district, the Board of Ordained Ministry. There's a responsibility he has every year at this time to help interview the ordinands, the folks that are going into ordained ministry. So he is doing that this weekend and even into next week. It's an important job, and so we're glad he does that, and I'm really glad he does it because it gives me an opportunity to preach to you too. So. If we're being honest. But no, be in prayer for him, and we're glad that he's doing the work of the Methodist Church. So that's where he is, and he sends his love. So today, kind of like having Jesus behind me here. Today we're beginning a new sermon series, a Lenten sermon series on the I Am sayings found in John's Gospel. And today we're going to talk about I am the bread of life. There were 7 I am sayings in John's Gospel. We're going to talk about 6 of them. And you may remember in Exodus chapter 3 that God reveals his name to Moses. And he says what? I am. So as we study these I am sayings of Jesus over the next few weeks, let us remember that Jesus is not only revealing who he is by identifying himself with the name of God, but Jesus is also revealing what he does and what that means to us as believers. So I want you to think about 4 questions today as you listen to this sermon and see if you can answer them when we finish, okay? 4 questions. Who is Jesus? What does he offer? How do I get it? What does that mean for me? Who is Jesus? What does he offer? How do I get it? What does that mean for me? So I want to begin this morning with a question. By a show of hands, how many of you have ever overeaten? Wow. Thanks for your honesty. Pretty much the whole room. You know, there seems to be this fine line between satisfaction and misery when we eat. And I've tried to find that line, but I always exceed the mark. I'm a notorious overeater. I love good food, and when presented with lots of it, I cannot control myself. I've been blessed to have some great opportunities to eat. Think about it. Thanksgiving and Christmas dinners, church potluck, buffets, office parties, pancake breakfast, vacations. I'm always in search of good food and lots of it. And when I find it, I just want to try it all. My eyes are always bigger than my stomach. And as I waddle away from the table cursing myself for my lack of self-control, I think, I am so full, I don't think I'll eat for a whole week. Y'all ever been there? And then what happens the next morning? You're hungry again. I don't understand it. I ate 5,000 calories and then just sat on the couch and did nothing. Why am I hungry already? And why can I not button my pants? I think most of us know how the body works. It requires food daily, and although it stores the excess as fat for the days that we don't eat as much, we always have this hunger inside of us. It's a daily desire, a self-preserving instinct, and a biological certainty that we need to eat. And what we had yesterday won't stop our body from craving something new today. So even when I diet, which isn't very often, and my body has to tap into the stored energy that encircles my waistline, it still lets me know it's not happy with me. It grumbles in anger and protest from within my stomach because it prefers to be fed from the table and not from the abundance of my fat. Stomachs don't like to be empty, and full stomachs feel wonderful. But that feeling doesn't last. And that's exactly what's going on in our text today that Kevin read. Just a few verses before our reading, we see Jesus feeding 5,000 men plus women and children. Folks, that's about 20,000 people. And if you can't imagine how many people that is, have any of you ever been to the Bridgestone Arena? And you've seen it at full capacity and you just look around at all the sea of people, maybe at a concert. That's not quite 20,000 people. That's a lot of people. These people followed Jesus up a grassy hillside in Galilee in the middle of nowhere, and they got hungry. And there's no way they could all be fed. And Philip is like, Jesus, it would take 200 denarii to even give them a taste of bread. That's a day's wage for 200 people. And Andrew says, well, there's this kid over here with 5 loaves of barley and 2 fish. That certainly wouldn't be enough. And of course, we know that Jesus fed all of these people with this kid's Lunchable. And it was more than a taste. It was a buffet. Right up my alley. It wasn't just a snack. 20,000 people ate like I do until they were completely and utterly stuffed. And there were still 12 baskets left over. Can you imagine 20,000 people laying on the grass on a hillside in Galilee in a food coma? After seeing this miracle, or sign as it said in the text, the crowd begins to identify Jesus as the prophet, capital P, who would come into the world. The crowd, they remember something that Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you for your brother, from your brothers. It is in him you shall listen. So they attempt to force Jesus to be their king and Messiah, and well, Jesus isn't having any of that. And he withdraws up the mountain by himself. So our scripture reading this morning picks up the day after this event when those in the bliss of a food coma yesterday wake up hangry and unsatisfied today. Y'all ever been hangry? You know what that is? I love that word. Angry and hungry put together. So the first thing that these folks do is they go looking for their meal ticket. They go looking for Jesus. But they can't find him, so they make their way across the lake, the Sea of Galilee, to the town of Capernaum, and they find him there. And when they find him, Jesus knows what they're after, another meal. Jesus isn't fooled. He knows the hearts of people, and he says in verse 26, "You are seeking me because you ate your fill of the loaves." In other words, I know why I'm so important to you. You want me to give you more free food. Now, I'm not saying that food isn't important, because it is. But Jesus didn't come to dispense food for a living. That isn't his ministry. It's bigger than that. Jesus came to save us, not enable us. Those folks could have packed up and gone back to the village the next morning, but they paddled and they rowed and they walked miles around the Sea of Galilee to locate Jesus. They were working really hard to get some of that free food. And the irony is that the crowd had just witnessed a miracle of epic proportion yesterday, and they were more concerned with the results of the miracle than the truth that the miracle revealed. They wanted the gift rather than the giver. This whole story is a classic adventure in missing the point. Now, I would have been done with the crowd, but not Jesus. He uses this moment to teach them more about who he really is and the truth about what he can offer. So he tells them in verse 27, "Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." In other words, you're working so hard for the wrong things that won't satisfy you. Work for something that's eternal, which I will give you because God approved me to do it. You see, Jesus is rearranging their priorities. Y'all ever had someone do that in your life? Rearrange your priorities. My dad used to call it a come to Jesus meeting. And they always involved a change in my behavior in order to realign myself with the expectations of my mother and father, thus preventing further conflict. And guess what? They always worked. So here in the synagogue of Capernaum, we may have one of the very first, the OG, as the kids like to say, come to Jesus meetings. But the people still don't get it. They're still thinking about barley loaves and pickled fish. You see, Jesus is trying to teach them about something better, but they're like, what's better than free food? Did you know that we can live about 3 days without water and about 3 weeks without food? But Jesus wants them to know they can't live eternally 3 seconds without him. We can't make it without Jesus. Jesus is the way, the truth. He is life. We're not meant to just exist in this life and then die. God put his breath in us. We have the Spirit of the living God in us. We are meant to live and to live abundantly and to live eternally. And Jesus is the key. But we have to want Jesus for who he is and not for what he can do to meet our earthly needs. Because if we're not careful, that becomes prosperity gospel. If we want Jesus because of what he does rather than who he is, that's idol worship. If we are to want Jesus, we must want relationship with Jesus. 1 John 4:19 says, "We love because he first loved us." So what does that love look like? What does the love of Jesus look like? It looks like the cross. It looks like love that would go to any length to save us. We sang about it today. So when confronted with love like that, what are we supposed to do with it? We should be rocked by it. I want you to ask yourself, have I allowed the love of Jesus Christ to transform me? Do I want what Jesus did more than who Jesus is? On our journey to Easter morning as a church, we must first climb to the foot of the cross and remember how far love went for us. Please let that sink in. We need to search ourselves and say, am I in love with the right Jesus? Not the vending machine Jesus, but the Jesus who gave his life for mine. Do you know that Jesus? Can I get an amen? Do you know that Jesus? Are you living like you know that Jesus? See, the things of this world are sometimes necessary, but are never paramount to Jesus. So we're just 5 days into the season of Lent, where we should be making a concentrated effort to repent and draw closer to Christ. But what's getting more attention in our lives right now? Let me get real with you for just a minute. Is it Wall Street? Is it your 401k? Is it the anxiety about the coronavirus? Is it Super Tuesday? Friends, it ought to be Jesus. Because nothing else will last. Nothing else will satisfy. We will find ourselves searching for the wrong bread again tomorrow, and we will be hangry. Jesus says to work for food that fills and satisfies and sticks to your ribs and never leaves you feeling empty. So the people in verse 28 ask Jesus, how do we get this bread? What work do we need to do? And Jesus tells them, you must believe. Believe in him who is sent from God. The work you need to do isn't good, clean living or keeping all the laws. It isn't trying harder until you achieve favor. The work is belief. It's faith. Now, you might think that faith is more of a concept than work. But you try having faith in something. It is hard work. We live in a world when we see it, we can believe it. When we touch it, then it's real to us. When we experience it, we can trust it. Jesus says, no, that isn't how I work. You've seen the signs. Now it's time to stop working for what won't fill you up and believe in me and God who sent me. And you know what? Sometimes that means stepping out in faith, jumping off the proverbial high dive in life, maybe even free falling for just a moment, but having the faith to know that God will never drop you. Many things in life will let you down, friends. Please understand this. God will never let you down. God is faithful, amen? But what happens next? Y'all with me so far? In verse 30, the people want proof. They want Jesus to give the manna from heaven like Moses did in the wilderness. Jesus quickly reminds them it wasn't Moses who gave them the bread of heaven, but God. He says in verse 31, for the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Yes, that's what we want, they say. Jesus, if you're greater than Moses, do it forever and then we will believe you. Give us this bread always. And then just when Jesus has them thinking about breakfast and they're licking their lips and they're imagining the contentment of a full stomach and wanting the bread that satisfies always, Jesus lays a truth bomb on them and says, you want that bread? I am that bread. Amen? I am the bread of life, Jesus says. I am the manna from heaven. Only I give life to the whole world. It isn't a boy's sack lunch that satisfied you for a day. It isn't manna on the ground that satisfied your grandfather's day by day for 40 years. It's me. I satisfy for eternity. In me you will find satisfaction spiritually, emotionally, relationally. The one thing that can satisfy the cravings of your life and meet the needs of your soul is found in me. Take me in, he says. Accept me into your life. Let me come to you and forever satisfy and eternally keep you. Jesus says, I can fill the void. I can bridge the gap. I can calm the storm. I am what you need. Believe in me. And so today, even as we are confronted about this truth, my prayer is that we we all stop searching for whatever is our proverbial next meal and come to love and adore the one who satisfies our souls. Finally, in verse 41, we read that the Jews began to grumble about him because he said, "I am the bread of life who came down from heaven." Folks, there's always going to be grumblers in the world. They are a surly, hangry bunch, and they don't get it. And if you think you have problems, Moses and Aaron had hundreds of thousands of grumblers to listen to for 40 years in the desert. But Jesus loves even those who grumble, those who miss the giver because they adore the gift more. And still he offers himself, the bread of life. I pray that the grumblers will come to accept the bread of life that satisfies, so they will hunger no more and grumble no more. And even those of us who know Jesus, maybe sometimes we've forgotten how much he loves us, and we've begun chasing the wrong bread again. May we be reminded of who satisfies, who endures, of who we believe in. As we study the truth revealed in this Come to Jesus meeting at Capernaum, may it resonate with you here at Springfield First United Methodist Church. For you need to be reminded that God loves you without price, and that you are the best thing that God has ever made. So stop working for food that spoils, and you know what yours is. Just believe. May we fill that God-sized hole in our lives with who has always desired to be there. Our first love, Jesus Christ. On this first Sunday in Lent, I leave you with an echo of the word spoken over you on Ash Wednesday. Repent and believe the gospel. I say these things in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. So what a fitting day as we speak about Jesus being the bread of life, satisfying us for eternity, to experience the table of grace, to experience Holy Communion. So as we come today, no, this is not a United Methodist table. This is a table for anyone and everyone. There are no qualifications. Just come. God wants you to come and experience the grace. There'll also be an opportunity for someone that has a gluten allergy to take communion at a special station in the center, because we want everyone to feel welcome. So you know the story. But on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. He asked you to bless it, God. And then he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, God. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, the cup of my blood. Take and drink this and do this as often as you can in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Gracious God, what an opportunity to come and experience the mystery of the faith, the mystery of the communion table. Lord, something that fulfills us, something that satisfies us, something that reminds us of what Jesus Christ did for us. Lord, this is an opportunity for us to come and commune with all the saints in glory. And so, Lord, we ask that as we take this, this be the body and blood of Christ for us, that you bless it by your Holy Spirit, and that as we take it in, we might be the body and blood of Christ redeemed by this world. Lord, we pray for that day when we feast at your heavenly banquet. And until that time, Lord, sustain us. Help us to be your hands and feet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to ask the communion servers to come forward. I invite you to come to the table of grace. Taste and see the Lord is good. Thank you. Are there others that need to be served from your seat? If you would, just lift the hand. We'll bring the elements to you. Is there anyone? So this is your opportunity to respond to the message, whether in your seat or at the rail. Know that God loves you. If you have something you need to say to Him, He knows your heart. Come in faith.
Stand with us, please, as we sing Refiner's Fire.
Purify my heart, let me be as gold, and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold, pure gold. Refiner's fire, my heart's one desire.
You've experienced the mercy, the grace, the love, the forgiveness offered by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit today as you've worshiped here at Springfield First. We're glad you're here. Receive this benediction. Go forth from this place satisfied, filled up, knowing that the God of the universe loves you and wishes to be everything to you. Believe. Amen. Because of your cross, my debt is paid. Because of your blood, my sins are washed away.